Okay. Okay, good. We're going to take up another example. This one related to curvilinear motion. So the simplest case of curvilinear motion is rotation about a point. So we'll start. We'll take an example and work our way through there. But before that, I want to lay out the general rules for curvilinear motion. So if I, let's say, have an origin and a point P that is tracing motion on a path, it's kind of generally curvilinear. We looked at Cartesian definition of the motion of this object. Another way is to define a position vector denoted by this r, and define a coordinate system in with respect to the local r. So I can define a unit vector called er and then e theta. E theta being locally tangential to the path being traced by the particle P, and er being along the particle P. So let's write down some very simple definitions. R is r times er, where now r is the magnitude of the position vector. So in the same coordinate system, just like we did with Cartesian, I can define a velocity of this particle as simply dr dt. Now when I do this, you essentially get d dt of r times er. The difference between this coordinate system and the Cartesian coordinate system is that the unit vector er is now subject to change with respect to time, whereas in the Cartesian coordinate system ex, ey and ez remain unchanged in both their magnitude and direction with respect to time. So because of that one added complexity, dr dt is can be written as r dot er plus r theta dot e theta. So this additional term arises because there is a rotation of the er vector, and the magnitude of that rotation is given by this theta dot e theta. Okay. So in the simplest, so we are going to take the simplest case of a particle P tracing a circular rotation about a point O, and this point is located 2 meters on the radius. The particle P is located 2 meters on a circle that is radius 2 meters with respect to a center O, and the acceleration in the angular sense is given by 4 cos 2 t radians per second squared, and we are asked to find the maximum velocity of the particle and the amplitude of the periodic motion. So as you will see, the angular acceleration has a cosine of 2 t kind of a dependence, which implies that it takes on a maximum and a minimum value and remains inside those two bounds for all times. Therefore, this is an example of periodic motion. So let's start with that. So so this gives us, so we're going to try to simplify this definition of the velocity for that case, but before we do that, we are having to also define an acceleration. So the acceleration is given by the same definition that we had in the coordinate system. So if I now do this differentiation, you end up with additional terms, and I'm simply going to write it because the mathematical derivation is fairly straightforward and occurs in almost all textbooks related to dynamics. So given a particle moving in an r theta coordinate, being whose motion is being defined in an r theta coordinate system, this part, this defines the total acceleration of this particle. So if r is unchanged in time, as is the case with our example, if r is constant equal to capital R equal to 2 meters, then r dot equal to r double dot equal to 0. So simplifying that, acceleration is minus a er plus r theta double dot a theta. This is the total linear acceleration. So, a is the linear acceleration which has units of meters per second squared. Remember that. Alpha, which is what we are given, is like our theta double dot. That has units of radians per second squared. And in our case, r equal to 2 meters and constant. So, let us go through and solve this example. And for that case, we find first of all that alpha is d omega dt, where omega is the angular velocity of the particle with about of the bar, as a matter of fact, carrying the particle p. Now, a common error that is found in some textbooks is they refer to the angular velocity of a particle. A particle is of a point mass and a point size. It has no discernible angular rotation. So, you are essentially in this problem interested in the angular motion of this bar OP, which carries the particle P at the end of it, and the bar has an angular acceleration alpha and an angular velocity omega. And similarly, just like in the case of linear one dimensional motion, omega is also given by d theta dt. So, let us start. Given alpha, I can find omega by doing a time integration, 4 cos 2 t dt plus an integration constant that arises out of the fact. So, which implies omega, which is a function of time, so at t equal to 0, omega of 0 equal to 0, which implies c in this particular integration is 0. So, we have determined the angular velocity of with respect to time as 2 sin 2 t. Going one step further, omega itself is defined as d theta dt, which implies theta as a function of time is integral omega dt plus another integration constant, I will call this C1. So, when I do this integration, 2 sin 2 t dt plus a C1. And we are told that at theta of 0, at time 0 is pi over 2, which implies theta of 0 is minus cosine 0 plus C1. So, we are asked, so theta as a function of time is minus cosine 2 t plus our integration constant, which happens to be that. So, we are asked the two questions. First, find the amplitude of this periodic motion. This amplitude has nothing to do with this number pi over 2 plus 1, that is just a phase shift in time. The amplitude is this number, which is kind of invisible, it is actually 1. So, the amplitude is 1 and it has units, which is radians. The second question that is asked is find the maximum velocity of this of p. let us go back, in order to find that, let us go back to our definition of omega. Omega happens to be of the form 2 sin 2 t. Omega takes on its maximum value when sin 2 t takes on a value of 1, which happens at t equals pi over 4, etcetera, and the maximum value of omega is 2 radians per second. So, first of all, omega max is 2 radians per second, and v, the linear velocity of p, or more precisely linear speed of p, is given by r times omega, which implies v max is r times omega max, which is equal to 2 into 2 meters per second, which is 4 meters per second. So, a quick recap. What we learnt is that in curvilinear coordinate systems, acceleration takes on a form such as that. Now, just again to recap from the previous video, why are we looking at acceleration? Because later on when we deal with forces, forces are proportional to, or acceleration caused is proportional to force. Therefore, we need to understand the motion of a particle in the context of acceleration. It is not enough to understand only its velocity. So, given this, there is 4 terms here. R double dot is simply the linear acceleration along ER. Likewise, R theta double dot is the linear acceleration along E theta. This part, R theta dot squared, is often referred to as the centripetal force. Although, remember, a centripetal acceleration, and this is often referred to as the Coriolis acceleration, but they are technically incorrect. We will refer to that this point when we start talking of kinetics in curvilinear coordinates in about a week or so. Okay, thank you.